Hi everyone and welcome back to the Serverless series. In the last video, we created our AWS credentials, and in this video, we'll be creating our very first serverless project and explore the structure of a project. Now we don't have to set up everything ourselves because serverless has a built-in create command that can do this for us. So let's pull up the help of this command and see what options it takes. So I'm going to type sls create dash dash help. And here we can see that it takes a template, a path, and a name. You can also see that the framework ships with many templates already available. These include templates for Node.js applications on AWS Lambda, as well as other languages on AWS Lambda, but also other platforms such as Azure and OpenWhisk. Now for this series, we'll be creating a Node.js application. So let's create one right now. I'm going to start by creating a new directory on my desktop, and I'm going to call this awesome API. And I'm going to change into that directory. And now I'm going to create a new serverless project. So I'm going to type sls create. Then I'm going to say that I want the AWS Node.js template. And that's it. I'm going to hit enter. And now serverless has created our application. It says successfully generated a boilerplate template for AWS Node.js. So let's open up this directory in Visual Studio Code to see what it looks like. So I'm going to open on my desktop awesome API. And serverless has created three files for us. It has created a gitignore file, which tells Git, the source control management system, which files to ignore. It created a handler.js file, which contains the source code for a simple function, and a serverless.yaml file, which is the project configuration file. Now, the function that they have created is really simple. It just exports a hello function, and this will receive details about the event that triggered it, some context, and then a callback function that it should call whenever it is done executing. Now, as I've said, this function is really simple. It just makes a response object with a status code of 200 and it passes along a body. Now the status code is a HTTP status code that will be returned to the client. So in this case, 200 means that everything went fine, but we might also return a 404 to indicate that a resource wasn't found, or a 500 to signify that there was a server error. Now in the body, we can return any string that we want. And in this case, they just take a JSON object, they stringify it, and then they set that to the body. After creating this response object, serverless returns it to the user by calling the callback function and passing along the response. Now the callback function has two parameters. It takes an error and a success message. The error message shouldn't be used because serverless framework uses the Lambda proxy integration by default. If you want to return an error, simply change the status code to an error code, such as, for example, 404 or 500. I'll talk about functions more detailed in a later video when we are creating our own function. Let's now take a look at the serverless.yaml file. This file contains all the configurations for your project. So it starts by giving a name for your service. In this case, it's AWS Node.js, and it says node, update this with your service name. So I'm going to start by doing that. I'm going to call my project awesome API. There we go. And this file also contains some other parameters, such as what our cloud provider is. In this case, it's AWS. What runtime that we want to use. In this case, it's the latest version of Node.js that is available on AWS Lambda. And it also contains the definitions for our function. So here we declare a function with name hello, and we say that the handler for this function is in the handler.js file, which is this one, and it's the exported hello function, which is this one. Now again, more on this later as we will create our own functions. Now is also a good time to make sure that you define the AWS region that you want to use. So if I scroll up, in the provider section, you can see that it has a stage and region variable. And so by default, the region is US East 1. If that's okay for you, you can leave that untouched. But for me, I want to use the EU region. So I'm going to use EU West 1. And you can also specify the stage that your project is in. So for example, you might have multiple branches in your Git repository, and one branch might be a staging environment and the other branch might be production. So in this case, by default, it says it's the development environment. You could also call it prod for production or any other stage name that you want. And this will get appended to the name of your functions that Serverless deploys. Now also notice all the other comments in this file. These show all the different things that you can configure. For instance, all the way at the bottom, we have a section called resources over here. And here you can specify all the AWS resources that your functions need. So say that your app needs an S3 bucket to store user uploads, well then you can define that bucket here. And in fact, they give you this example. They say that new resource is of type AWS S3 bucket, and the bucket name is my new bucket. The nice thing about this is that Serverless will deploy these resources for you, and it will use CloudFormation to do so. And that means that your infrastructure changes will be versioned, and if something would go wrong, it will automatically roll back the changes. So I'm going to save this file, and that was it for this video. We've created our very first project and looked at the structure of the generated files. In the next video, I will show you how to deploy this function and also how to run it offline on your machine for testing purposes. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this video, leave a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you in the next video.